Photometer will be the topic of the second part of the clinical chemistry analyzer. In this part, we will talk about the reagents, why we need reagents, and we'll give some examples. Then we'll talk about the principle for photometer. Then we'll have two examples for the photometer. The first one will be the photometer which is used by the Beckman and the EU analyzers, and the second photometer will be the one used by the Roche in all COBAS analyzers. Then we will make a comparison between these two photometers. So then now we'll start with the talk about the reagents. The first question will be, why do we need reagents? As we remember that firstly, in order to measure an analyte or any type of molecule or ion or macromolecules, firstly we add reagents. We make an incubation for them at 37 degree. We mix this reagent to have a homogeneous concentration. Then we add the sample, which will be a serum. Then we will make as the same as before. We make a mixing of the reaction in order to have the final product, or the end product, which will be the result of the analyte which we are interested in to be measured with the reagent. And we make incubation at the 37 degree, and finally we measure the absorbedness by this final end product. So firstly we add the reagent, we mix them to have a homogeneous content of this reagent at and we incubated the we incubate this reagent at 37 degree, which is the temperature of our core body. Then we add the sample, we make also the same steps, we make mixing and incubation, and finally we measure the absorbedness. As we can see, these are the steps for in order to measure an analyte concentration. Or so we need to add the reagents and to have measured the analyte. So why this? An analyte, an assay, for example, a glucose, uric acid, or whatever. So an analyte absorbs at a unique wavelength, not very common. So we cannot directly measure most of the analytes. We cannot measure the absorbedness directly at a unique wavelength. So in order to have the measurement or the absorbedness at a unique wavelength, we used a reagent. Consequently, an analyte should react with a reagent to produce an adduct, or we said the end product of the chemical reaction that absorbs at a unique wavelength. This is known as a chromophore. So we need a chromogen which will be the adding will be the result of adding the analyte with a reagent. So this is the first point which we should understand. We need reagent because we cannot measure directly at a specific wavelength. So we need to add this reagent in order to reach a final product known as a chromogen. Then we make the measurement or the absorbedness at this wave for this reaction at a specific wavelength. This reagent, as we can see here, this is a photo for the analyzer EU 400. We can see we have two type of reagents. We have reagent 1 and reagent 2. This reagent should be stored in the analyzer at a specific temperature, which should be ranged between 2 to 8 degrees. So we should have a refrigerator in the analyzer to avoid the change of the characteristic of this reagent, and we increase their stability on board, which means in the in this analyzer. This refrigeration is to avoid the evaporation. So we know we need to store these reagents at a specific temperature, which should be between 2 to 8, to avoid the evaporation and to change the characteristic of this reagent, which we need to know, which we need to have a stable concentration to avoid any inaccuracy in the reading of the analyte. So these reagents have a specific, each reagent or each analyte has a specific reagent with a specific information. So what information the analyzer need to know about this reagent? Firstly, what is type or test or analyte we are testing? For example, a glucose, a CRP, uric acid, and so on. If it's, as we said, we have two type of reagents. We have reagent one and reagent two. Most of the analytes need two reagents. Also, we should know if it's a reagent one and two reagent two to be preserve the sequence in the adding of the reagent with the analyte. We need to know the lot number. The lot number is very important. This lot number will be changed every, for example, 4 to 6 months. This depends on the production of these reagents by the manufacturer or supplier. Then we need to know the expiry date for this reagent. As we said, there's a lifetime for this reagent. Usually, to keep this reagent within this lifetime, we should keep as 2 to 7, 2 to 8 degree to avoid evaporation. So, in addition to that, we should know the expiry date. We should know also the analyzer, the serial number of this reagent. So how this information will be entered into the analyzer without to need without the need of the lab technician to make this manually. Usually we use tags. We have two type of tags. We have two types of tags. We have RFID tags and we have barcode label tags. Preferable is a passive, sorry, is a RFID, and we'll know now why we need, why it's better to have an RFID. So we can see here different photos for the tags, which is are used to transfer the information about these reagents to the analyzer. The first one is an RFID tag. It's an active one. We have two type of RFID. We have the active one, which has a memory and can store information and exchange the information with the analyzer, which is very important. Usually, every test we made will change the number of the test remain test for this analyzer. It's better this information also to be stored in addition to the analyzer to be stored in the with this tag for the reagent. This will be available only in the case of active RFID. Whereas if you can use the barcode label or the passive RFID, we don't have any information stored with the reagent itself. Why we need to store the information also in the reagent tag in addition to the analyzer. Sometimes due to a emergency failure or stop of the analyzer, we lose data in the due to the damage of the hard disk or the computer of the analyzer. So in order to avoid the entering manually of the content of each bottle, which will be approximated and could lead to an error, we use this RF tag, the active one, which will store the information. Okay, so this will avoid us from a big problem in case of the failure of the storage or the damage of the storage of the information about the reagent or other information related to the analyzer, in case we don't have any type of backup. So we have, as we said, an RFID, we have a passive and active, and we have the barcode label. As we can see, this is a 1D barcode label, and this is a 2D barcode label. The 1D will store less information than the information stored by the 2D. So even the 2D is preferable than the use of 1D barcode labels. This means if we use the 1D label, we some of the information will be entered manually into the into the analyzer. So the best choice will be the active RFID, where all the information, we can store a lot of information inside this microchip or the memory of this active tag. And this information will be exchanged with the analyzer each time we make a test or a calibration or a quality control test. Whereas in the case of the barcode labels, the information regarding the remaining number of the test in each reagent bottle will be stored only in the analyzer. And in the case of a damage of this storage, we will face problem if we don't have any type of backup. So the preferable type will be the use of the active RFID. So we addressed the first point, why we need reagents. The second point, which has been addressed, was the information needed to be stored in the analyzer, and preferable to also to be stored in the reagent tag memory chip or memory of the tag of the reagent. Now we'll give an example for some of the reagents for a specific analyte. For example, the phosphate. Phosphate usually exists in our body into two forms. The first form will be the organic, which is existed inside a cell, and the other type of the phosphate, which will be the inorganic phosphate, which is existed in the plasma and intraterrestrial fluid. We cannot measure directly phosphate, so we add, as we can see here, two type of reagents, and we measure the wavelengths at two specific wavelengths. The first will be at 340 nanometer, and the second one will be at 600 to 700 nanometer. So we have two type of the phosphate, organic and inorganic. We usually interested in serum and the inorganic phosphate, which is measured to have information about the patient. The second example will be triglyceride. We usually also add reagents to reach a final product, which will be the hydrogen peroxide. Then we measured this at a specific wavelength, which will be 500 nanometer. Another point to mention regarding this test, usually a low density lipoprotein is not measured, is an analyte which is not measured directly. We measured for the total cholesterol, the high density lipoprotein cholesterol, and we measure the triglyceride. Then we use this formula in order to calculate the concentration for LDL. So this is another example for the reagent. As we said, now to recap the information concerning the reagent. First, we cannot measure an analyte or a test directly at a specific wavelength. So we used the reagent to have an end product reaction known as a chromogen. Then we measure this chromogen at a specific wavelength. The information of this, we have two type of reagent. We have R1 and R2. Usually most of the analyte needs two type of reagent, R1 and R2. As we said, we have information regarding this reagent. We have the first information will be what type of the reagent, if it's R1 or R2, then we need to know the lot number, which will be changed every 4 to 6 months, and this will change the characteristic of these reagents. Then we need to know the lot number. Also an important information we should know, what is the number of remaining tests inside the reagent bottle. Sometimes this information is stored in the analyzer. We don't have, in case of barcode labels or passive RFID, the storage of this information on the tag itself. Whereas in the case of an active RFID, this information regarding the remaining number of the test inside the reagent bottle will be stored in the memory chip of this active RFID. Also, the last point which we should know that this reagent should be stored at a cold temperature. At a cool temperature will be between 2 to 8 to avoid the evaporation of the liquid inside this reagent bottle. And this because this evaporation will lead to the change of the concentration of this reagent, and consequently will lead to the inaccuracy of this measurement of analyte. Now we'll talk about the principle of the photometer. Photometer is based on Beer-Lambert law. Usually, as we said, we use a specific. We have two type of system for the of photometers. We have what we call a monochromatic photometer and bichromatic photometer. Monochromatic use only one specific wavelength for the measurement of an analyte, whereas bichromatic system use two wavelengths, which is usually used by the Roche diagnostic. One wavelength will be used for the measurement of the analyte and the chromogen, which is related to the analyte, and the second wavelength will be the measurement of the light interference and to eliminate this interference. Okay, so the principle based on Beer-Lambert law, which is of the photochemistry, which is the absorbance of the light by a specific material or a molecule or ion. We use a monochromatic light which passes through the solution or the end product, the reagent with the analyte, which form a chromogen. There's a quantitative relationship between the solute concentration and the intensity of the transmitted light or the light absorbed by this end product. Higher concentration means higher absorption of light and reduction in the transmitted light. The amount of the absorbed light is proportional to the concentration of this analyte, and we will see the formula for this later. So photometry measures the concentration of various analytes. For example, as we said, the glucose, uric acid, bilirubin, cholesterol, LDL, HDL, and so on, by measuring the absorbance of light as a optical density. So photometry measures the concentration of various analyte by measuring the absorbance of the light as optical density. In order to have this measurement at a specific wavelength, a monochromator or filter is used to select this desired wavelengths for each analysis, depending on the properties of the substance being measured. So now we'll discuss two types of photometer, commercial photometers, the one which is manufactured by Roche Diagnostic and the one used or manufactured by the Beckman Coulter. We'll start with the one which is used by the Beckman Coulter. Prior to start this discussion, I will give some information regarding how to separate the wavelengths, why we use a specific type of monochromator or filter. Usually, the separation of a light can be made by different methods. One of the methods is the use of the prism. However, as we can see, the separation between the wavelengths due to the characteristic of this prism leads to the separation of the wavelengths unequally. And this will lead to an interference between the reading at the specific wavelengths, which is not preferable. The better choice will be the use of the diffraction grating, which lead to the unequal separation of the wavelengths, as we can see here and here. I will not discuss the principle of these monochromator or filters. However, I only interested in explain the difference between them and why we're interested in the use of the diffraction grating. So the use of the diffraction grating is better because of the equal separation between the different wavelengths. Usually, as we said, the measurement in the chemistry analyzer on the photometer of the chemistry analyzer is done at a specific wavelength. So we should avoid any interference from other wavelengths. This is will be accomplished use the diffraction grating, whereas the use of the prism will lead to this interference, and this is not preferable. This is the photometer. So we have the source light, we have the cuvette where we have the end product reaction, which is the result of the addition of the reagent and analyte or serum, and mixed and incubated at 37 degrees. Then this will be entered into this dispersion device, or what we call the monochromator or filter, and we can see here the separation. As we can see, the separation is not equally, and this is not preferable. These are the diode array or the photodiode detector. At each position we have a photodiode for a specific wavelengths. By using of the prism, we don't have an equally separation of these wavelengths, and we have interference, and this is not preferable. So we don't usually use the diffraction or the prism, we use the diffractive grating or diffraction grating. The principle is reflective. As I said, I will not discuss this. I prefer only to focus why we need to use this diffractive grating or diffraction grating. This is a photometer which is used by the Beckman and their EU analyzers. We have, as we can see, this is a photometer. This is a lamp. As we can see, here's the lamp. This is a photometer. This is a cover. This is a reaction place. Inside here, we have, as we said, we have the prism, we have lenses, and we will see this in the second block diagram. In the next slide, we have also the diffraction grating. We have also the photodiode detectors. So this is the block diagram of the above photometer. We have a lamp, which is a halogen lamp. It will be a 12 volt DC with 200 watt halogen lamp. The light will be condensed using illumination lens on the cuvette. As we see, this light is condensed here, and this light will be absorbed according to the Beers-Lambert law, as we said before, in order to measure the concentration of an analyte or test like glucose or uric acid or whatever. Then relay lenses will transfer this light through a slit into the diffraction grating, which separate the different wavelengths of the light, and this will be directed into the photodiode array. We have a specific wave, at a specific position, photodiodes. So we have 13 photodiodes for the one used by the Beckman. 13 photodiodes at a specific position. As we can see, we have an equally separation as a result of the grating or diffraction grating. This is a photometer. This is a photometer. This is a light source. This is a photo. This is a covent, or what we call the reaction cells. So this is the photometer used by the Beckman. This is the one. And this is a block diagram for it. This is a covent or the reaction cell. This is a lamp, halogen lamp. So the principle, as we said, is the Beers-Lambert law. This is the equation for the Beers-Lambert law. We measure the absorbance, which is will be the intensity of light, the initial intensity. Then we measure the transmitted one, and by then we can calculate the absorbance. So the absorbance will be measured. We have, according to the Beers-Lambert law, we have the distance, which will be the length of this reaction cells. Usually in this is the one which is used by the Beckman. It's a reusable type. This is important information, and we'll discuss this later. The cuvette used by the photometer by the Beckman is reusable one. It has a length of, as we can see here, this is the length, this is a light pass. It will be around 6 millimeters. This is a constant 6 millimeter. This is also constant related to the analyte at a specific wavelength. This is measured, so then we calculate the concentration of this analyte. So this is the formula used for the calculation of an analyte. As we said, we have different wavelengths. Usually the photometer used by the Beckman has 13 wavelength lengths, which start at which can with a range from 340 nanometer to 800 nanometers. These are the 13 wavelengths which are used by Beckman analyzer, EU analyzers. Also, I want to mention some information about this photometer. First of all, this is this covered wheels is a motorized one. It's controlled by a stepper motor. As we can see, this covets will be rotate, and this rotational movement will be controlled by a stepper motor. Another information that the reaction covets will be kept at 37 degree, which will be the core temperature, in order to have this incubation temperature. As we can see, we have here a liquid, a green liquid. It's a cooling liquid, which will help to avoid the rise of the temperature surrounding the lamp, and consequently will length or the life of the lamp, the halogen lamp. And also this temperature of the cooling will be used to reach the 37 degree for this covet. So the using of the cooling liquid will have two advantages. The first advantage will cooling of the lamp and will length the lifetime for this lamp. The second advantage of this using is to make incubation of this reaction cells or covets at 37 degree. The second information which you have discussed, that this, the movement of this covet wheels is controlled by a stepper motor. Finally, this lamp is a 12 volt DC lamp with 20 watt power. Now we'll discuss the photometer, which is made by Roche or used by Roche. As we can see here, the same, we have a halogen lamp. Also, we can see here the red tube, which is containing a cooling liquid in order to cool the temperature of the surrounding lamp. Also, we use this temperature to make the incubation of these reactive or reaction cells at 30 or covets at a 37 degree. The first point I want to mention about the photometer, which is used by the Beckman, by Roche, sorry, that the reaction cells or the covets are semi-reusable and should be exchanged every month. So why in the Beckman we have a reusable one, whereas in the Roche we use Roche analyzers, which are called Cobas analyzer, use a semi-reusable one, which would be changed monthly, and we will discuss this point later in this part. So this is the lamp. Here the reaction cells, and here we can see the, we cannot see where there is the photometer, and we will see the block diagram for the, this one. The lamp will be a 12 volt, but instead of 20 watt, which was used by the Beckman, we have the 50 watt power rating. So this is a block diagram for the photometer, which is used by Roche Cobas analyzers. Similarly to the Beckman one, which is used by EU analyzer, we have a lamp, a halogen lamp, 12 volt, 50 watt lamp, halogen lamp. We have the condensing lamp, which condenses the light in the reaction cells or the covets, which are incubated at 37 degree. Then this light will be passed through a slit and will be directed to the diffraction grated, which separate the wavelengths at a specific positions. Here we have a 12 photodiodes, not 13 photodiodes, to measure the different analytes. So this part, as we said, this part will be the photometer. These are the reaction cells, and these are the lamp with the condensing or focusing lens. As we said, the main difference is this type of reaction cells or covets, which is semi-reusable by Roche, where it is reusable by Beckman. Also, the another difference is the use of 12 photodiodes, whereas in the case when we use 13 photodiodes. And we have also another differences, and we'll discuss this later. So as we said, we use 12 wavelengths, which will range from 340 till 800 nanometers. So what is the principle? When the light beam enters a photometer, it strikes a diffraction grating, as we said before, to separate the lights equally. And this light will be measured by 12 photodiodes. Each photodiode is permanently positioned at a specific to detect light at a specific or different wavelengths. So we have a unique position for this photodiode. Absorbance readings are taken each time a reaction cell rotates past the photometer. As we said, we have a rotational movement of this reaction cells, and this is controlled by a stepper motor. When the reaction cells passes through the photometer light pass, the absorbance will be made at 12 wavelengths for each individual assay is measured. So we have the measurement at 12 wavelengths, and this should be made, for example, in the case of Roche, at 57 points or 57 times. So this is, as we said, the photometer used by the Beckman is called monochromatic system, whereas the one used by Roche is called bichromatic system. So what is the difference between monochromatic and bichromatic? Monochromatic use only one wavelength to the measure of the analyte or the end product as a result of the reaction between a chemical reaction between analyte and the reagents R1 and R2, and whereas in the bichromatic we use two wavelengths. The first wavelength, as we call the primary, this is the one used by Roche. The first wavelength is called the primary wavelength. The second wavelength is called the secondary wavelength. The primary, we as we can see here, we have three curves. The first curve will be the interferent curve, which is the result of the interference from the background. Okay, from the light of the surrounding environment. This is the curve for the absorption of the chromogen, which will be the end product of the chemical reaction between reagent and analyte. And the last one will be the absorbedness of or what we call the total absorbedness for both of these two curves, the chromophore and the interferent. So we made the first measurement at a wavelength, which is the primary. We measure the total absorbedness. Then we make the measurement at another wavelength we call the secondary, which is not related to the chromaffin or to the chromogen or the analyte. This one is used to measure the interference. So we have two wavelengths. One measures the interference and one measure the total absorbedness. By subtraction the absorbedness of the total from the interference, we can calculate the chromogen or the absorbedness by the chromogen. So this principle is called bichromatic. Then the second point comes to our mind: why Roche used a bichromatic system whereas Beckman used a monochromatic system? So as we said, most Roche diagnostic photometric tests use two wavelengths, one for the measurement of the end product chromogen, and the second one will be used for the measurement of the interference. We measure the total absorbedness of chromogen with the interference, then we measure the interference by the subtraction of this of the total from the interference. We can have the absorbedness for the chromogen. This is done to eliminate the effect of interferences sometimes found when using a single wavelength, which is a monochromatic system. The second reason, to compensate for most of the photometric noise, which is the noise will be the result of the surrounding light. For each reaction cell, a water blank is measured, and then absorbedness readings are taken 57 times. So we will take a 57 points or measuring points in 10 minutes. So in 10 minutes we'll start the measurement of the water blank, and I will explain later what is a water blank. Then we will make the measurement at 57 points for 10 minutes. So as we said, we have a primary wavelength and we have a secondary wavelength, and we discuss the difference between them. Okay. So now we'll make the comparison between the two types of the photometers, the one used by the Beckman and the one used by Roche. As we can see here, the first remark that the photometer, which is used by Roche, is usually uncovered, whereas the one which is used by the Beckman is covered. So why this the reaction cells are not covered, whereas the reaction cells or COVIDs are covered in the Beckman system? The second point that the Roche use a dichromatic system, as we said before, whereas the Beckman use a monochromatic system. A dichromatic means use two wavelengths, one for measurement and another to eliminate ambient light interference due to the uncovered top, whereas in the Beckman we use a monochromatic system for the measurement of analyte. Okay, which have a cover top. So another point concerning the wavelengths, we measure at 13 wavelengths in the Beckman, whereas in the Roche we measure at 12 wavelengths. Beckman having 13 photodiodes in the detector, whereas in the Roche they have 12 photodiodes, and this is the different wavelengths for each one of them. So we can see that we have a small difference between them. Another important and the comparison is the type of the COVIDs or reaction cells. The one used by Roche is a semi-reusable and should be monthly changed, whereas the one used by Beckman is a reusable. So why Beckman use reusable one, whereas in the case of the Roche they use a semi-reusable, which should be changed monthly? The reason behind all this is the mixing principle. As we said before in the first slide, we have a sequence. Firstly, we add a reagent, we make incubation and mixing of those reagents, and we add after a certain period the sample, then we make a mixing of the sample with the reagent, and we make the incubation, and finally we make our absorbness. So the main difference between this Roche and Beckman is due to the mixing principle of the reagent and the reagent with the sample. Usually Beckman use a mixing bar, rotational mixer, a spiral rod bar, or what we call spiral rod mixer, whereas Beckman use an ultrasonic mixer. The use of the spiral rod mixer will not lead to a damage some damage to the reaction cells, whereas the use of this ultrasonic mixer will lead to the some cracks in this reaction cells, and this is the real reason behind the need to exchange or to replace these reaction cells or COVIDs every month. So why then, what is the reason that Roche use this type? Also, it needs to replace the reaction cells, and this is the reason why Roche keep the reaction cells wheel uncovered, because we need to replace it monthly, and to avoid a lot of steps they make this cover uncovered, and consequently for this we use two wavelengths. So the main reason is the using of the mixing ultrasonic mixer, which lead to a damage of the COVIDs, and for this reason we make this COVIDs uncovered to easy of the remove. And for this reason, we use bichromatic system, because these COVIDs have an interference from the ambient light. So what the most important question, why Roche use this type of the mixing mixer, and why Beckman use this type of the mixer? This type of mixer have some disadvantage, okay, which are eliminated by the use of the ultrasonic. The first disadvantage, as we can see, we have a green material, which for antimicrobial or antibacterial, to avoid of the formation of the bacterial. But sometimes this material will be rot, and as a result, we'll have some contamination, what we'll call cross contamination. Sometimes also this is made of a metal, and the erosion of this metal will lead to some inaccuracy in the result on of analytes. Another reason so to avoid cross-contamination and inaccuracy due to the some pieces of the metal due to the erosion, whereas the use of ultrasonic will avoid this cross-contamination and the probable inaccuracy due to the small pieces of the metal of the of this rod. But the disadvantage of the ultrasonic mixer, as we said before, is the changing of the characteristic of the reaction cells, which lead to the damage of this reaction cell or cuvettes, the appearance of the cracks as the use of the ultrasonic mixer. And this is the reason behind the use of being semi-reusable and should be changed monthly. This is a photo for the principle of the ultrasonic mixer. As we see, we have these piezoelectrical elements. This is a reaction cuvette, and this is a reflector. So the ultrasonic wave will pass through the cuvette, which lead to the mixing of the reagent and the reagent and samples to have a homogeneous content, then will be reflected by the reflector and lead to this mixing flow. This is the mixer which is used by Roche. Finally,